All right, everybody, welcome back to Sketchcraft Live. Hopefully the stream holds. Today, tonight, whenever you're watching this, I shall be coloring the Spider-Man you see here with these Copic markers you see here. Joining me today is Brandon from leadheavyart.com. Leadheavy.
LeadHeavy.com.
Man, fucking fix your email, bro. Fuck every time.
I think I kind of like that. You don't like
Hey, good for you, bro, but when people are
it.
like trying to type in your email, it's your fucking problem, not mine, you
Right.
know? Good for you know? I kind of like that people don't know what the hell you're talking about, Rob. That does well for my bottom line. All right. So, I'll call out Copic markers as always as I'm working right along here. This is a copy of the pencils. I've drawn it separately and then I print out this stuff. I've tinted the lines this time. Sometimes I do that. I already did a rough experimentation. Ignore this. Calling out some numbers and stuff for myself. So I found that this actually helps just waste an extra piece of paper doing it, but whatever. Saves me from having to go back and like the Star Fox, you know what I mean? Paper I'm printing out on and working on is B marker paper. B marker paper. So, print this out. It's actually meant to be seen like this, but I'll be coloring right side up so my brain doesn't fucking go loco here. Gonna start with the W3, just do some creative edging. Not really gonna do any shadowing on him because he's gonna be a little bit more bright and poppy. So, here we go. How you been, Brandon?
So-so. Work was non-existent the last probably 10 days, and out of nowhere he's like, "Hey, I got an assignment for you if you could have it done by Wednesday, but hopefully you could have it done by tomorrow." And I'm like, "All right." And he's like, "It's a big assignment too." So I'm like, "Oh, sweet. I'm not sleeping tonight."
Welcome to the world of fucking bullshit production, right?
Yeah.
Time for you to pay your dues. I remember when I was told that by the David over at Ape. He's like, "Why not, Rob? You gotta pay your dues." And I had already been doing t-shirts for like several years, you know? Getting cursed at and shit. I'm like, pay my fucking dues.
But I need the money so I can be like, "No, nah, I don't want this assignment. Hit me on the
Yeah,
next
well,
one."
the first time you say no, guess what happens?
Yeah.
It's the last time you hear from him. Give it a year. That's exactly what ends up happening. I mean, so you gotta figure out what game you're in, you know? So you're in the fucking acquiring work game. So you just say yeah. It's like the cover I did for Retro, you know what I mean? They were like, "Oh, we need it by the 1st of February." Then I talked to the art director after I turned in the first draft, you know, my first turn in. And I was like, "So when's this really due?" He's like, "Oh, we really don't need it till like the 13th of February." He's like, "But I doubt the issue will be done by then anyhow." So I went back and recolored it, and he saw that. And then issue's still in now. I checked out their Twitter yesterday and it's like, "Yeah, we're thinking mid-March." But I like it. I like the art got turned in before their fucking writing, you know? It's nice. This
Seeing him.
creative edging is sorry. This creative edging is something that I end up deleting actually from the final art, like when I go digital. It's really just with the physical art piece, you know? But it looks pretty good. And then I've tried adding this after, but it smears colors. So if you're gonna do it, you gotta do it before you start. You were gonna say?
I was gonna say, so you thought I'd be months before I was back on the recording.
It's been almost an entire month.
Just not good timing for
It takes
both of
30
us.
days. Anytime someone starts a new job, I did just disappear. Like, come on, man. I know the
Well,
deal.
your timing's bad though. It's like
It's not my timing.
if you hit me up anytime before
Yeah,
five,
it's
it's fine,
my
but
fault. You're right. It's my fault.
it
How
is.
many times have I hit you up before five, dude? Plenty of time. You're fucking crazy. I gotta start logging when I email you or call you.
Yeah.
What about now? Do you know what it'll be? Well, today was the one time, because, yeah, sure, right, the one time. All right. You got me. Stay been busy, man. Don't blame me. I shoulder enough blame in my life. I don't need you piling on, dude.
But, like, I don't know when it was, last Monday or something, and I'm like, I was like, we gotta get home. I told Rob I'm gonna record, and then I rush, and then right before you get home, you're like, yeah, I'm done for the day. I was like, ah, oh, shit. It's like, damn,
yeah,
it.
That's how it goes, bro. I got my work done. I got my work done. I'm not staying up late. I'm fucking out, dude.
Alright.
So, today was a little bit, I'm a little behind, but that's because scanning these things in takes a little bit longer than you think sometimes.
Did they even change out your router?
That was all Sunday, yeah, but I mean, I had some drops today, but it didn't really affect some stuff I was streaming on this rig, so I don't know, you know what I mean?
Right.
We'll just see how it goes. But yeah, I mean, like, I tried to stream when I was drawing this guy, and that didn't work out very well. Like, it crashed.
Are we recording podcast this week?
Wednesday. Let's give it 10:30.
Your time or my time?
My time. Always my time, bro. I don't know your time.
Sounds good to me.
I'm going to record Game Cave at 9. I got Wesley, James. I invited Andy to come back for that, so...
Yeah, he already texts me all excited. He's like, we're talking Nintendo. I love Nintendo and all that. You know, the
cat. He doesn't listen to the podcast, right? Like, because that's all I ever do. You know, drives fucking Wesley and them batshit crazy. Why do you care so much? I'm like, because it's my fucking podcast. You fucking do your own shit. Why do I care?
I went and bought Mega Man ZX. I was playing that the last day or so. I felt like playing some Mega Man and side-scrollers. Did you like any of that or no? Or did you ever play any of that?
The original Mega Man X games are pretty cool. The Zero game's not really my thing, but, you know.
Alright. Because they had the... Was it the Zero?
I really like Mega Man Legends. I just wish someone would... fucking fix the play control on that, like just add dual analog support.
Alright.
But, you know.
I would buy a Nintendo Wii if they had like that, where they had the Mega Man Legends and, you know, like maybe like how PlayStation's doing their...
Will never happen. Capcom, they were making Mega Man Legends 3 exclusively for 3DS, and Capcom just dropped it for no reason. That's why Inafune quit Capcom. And he's making Mighty No. 9.
Oh, yeah, that's right, Andy.
Of course, he waited 2 years because of his non-compete. That's why, like, when I was having this conversation with, like, the guys over at Retro, you know, like, oh, he's going to get totally sued. I'm like, no, I don't think you get it. He waited the 2 years. You look at the day he left and time, you know, you can't get sued because you made something similar to something you'd done before. You know, like, we used to get into this in animation. It's like there was a guy, you remember the cartoon Bobby's World?
Yeah.
That guy sold off the look of his art to that company. He was never allowed to draw commercially like that again, you know, like, and that doesn't happen anymore. You can't sell a look, you know, like, he ended up suing and successfully winning after that shit, but, yeah. So, what they really do is assign these non-competes. So, he was non-competing for 2 years. I said, if anything, Capcom will end up publishing it, which will be the weird turn of fucking fate, being that they wouldn't fucking do shit with Mega Man, you know, but whatever. A Halo here with BO5. I'm going to go to lunch next week with my buddies over at IDW.
Nice.
Already turned down working for him, so now we can all go to lunch and catch up. Jarvey nuts.
It's just funny. It's it's you're at the stage where I wish I was at, where you could just no, I'm good.
Oh no. Believe me. No one ever says anyone's at that stage. Why would you ever turn down work? It's like you ever seen that episode of Seinfeld, do the opposite? Like Costanza just starts doing the opposite and he starts to have total success in his life. I've just decided all the moves I ever made were completely like I'm just doing the opposite of everything I would have ever done before. And it's working.
Just to touch back on that. Is that the one where he comes into work wearing like a t-shirt and
like, No, he didn't have a job at the time. He'd been out of a job for like through two or three seasons.
Oh, okay.
Rob, that's a fictional character. I'm like, yeah, well, artists model a lot of their lives after fictional characters. That's,
Right.
It's new there,
You ever watched the movie Monkey Bone?
Long time ago, dude. That's Bob Selleck, Henry Selleck, the guy who directed that, ended up doing Coraline, He directed Nightmare Before Christmas, but he never got any credit for it.
Did you like it?
Monkey Bone?
Yeah.
No, it's a comedy of errors, dude, but it holds up in a strange way, more like a cult film now,
Right. Yeah. I was watching it last night or the night before, and, I mean, Brandon Fraser, he's cool, he's fun, but I like the style of everything, over the top, shapes, and...
Yeah, that's Henry Selick right there, that's the art director. Yeah.
Jessica didn't really kind of try putting it on. I was like, just give it like 10 minutes. She's like, I'm over it. I was like, all right.
Yeah, it's a cult movie. Yeah.
Let's see.
I've actually had my schedule down pretty good the last 2 weeks. Like, I'm actually writing every day at the same time, working on commissions every day at the same time, and then this stuff every day at the same time, like, and then going to sleep, stopping at a certain time, And
right.
It's working, like, actually, it's amazing how that can actually...
I thought on the knee there, did you have on the original sketch, like, the knee ripped open, the costume?
No.
Oh.
Just look at the you're seeing into the shading, bro. No, his costume isn't ripped.
I hate drawing Spider-Man.
Why?
I'm not good enough yet with bodies to even attempt his abnormally moving body, I guess. I don't know. I just have trouble with it. Like, because all, the legs curling underneath and the footing, I just...
It depends on who draws them, right?
Yeah. I mean,
John Romita Sr. didn't really do any of that shit,
Right. He was just big and blocky, I guess.
I mean, like, I draw him skinny here because I don't want to hear it from people, but... I subscribe more to the McFarlane way of drawing him, I never really saw him as an ultra skinny guy. But that seems to be the zeitgeist now, When you start to play him against like Venom and stuff, I guess the shapes pop better that way, but if I were drawing just me as Spider-Man, he wouldn't be ultra thin, but I let this one go, I'm like, whatever, he's fine. It's fun drawing little skinny dudes.
Right.
I know you'd appreciate the thinner Spider-Man. You like your men skinny, right? Right, Brandon?
You know it.
That's true.
There's only one big bear in the relationship, isn't me.
That's right. That is right. I learned that. was the big question tonight. Was like, do I make Venom purpley or bluish? I side on purple, but because it's Marvel Capcom, I just said, well, fuck it, I'll just go with the blues. Seemed to be he's more bluish in the game anyway.
Yeah, and the game is bluish, but I always think that when like an object is so dark black, I always like it when it has a purple shade.
Well, what I'm gonna do, just to put a little in there, is all edge light the his blues with the VO4, not on Spider-Man, but like on Venom. So there'll be these purple hues around the edge, you know? So they'll be in there, but yeah, I guess I did a purplish version, and it just didn't look like the one from the game, you know?
All right.
And that's when I was like, well, I don't want to hear it, you know? I can always throw some extra lighting in on the digital side, you know?
Right.
Like his slime, his little green venom slime will be digital. I'm not even gonna attempt it with the markers. Markers, these markers don't do very well with those kinds of little details. Tend to make a mess. Supposed to get both of them colored tonight, but with scanning and everything else, I was like, well, I'm pretty sure I can get Spider-Man done though. Plus, my neck has been killing me. I slept on it wrong. That's always tough, right? Like,
Right.
you're like, I gotta look down. There's no way I can marker this shit vertically.
Yeah, I don't know if I tweaked mine at volleyball last Thursday or sleeping out wrong, but I woke up the other day too and it kills, and I'm just like sitting here at the desk and I'm just like, no.
Yeah, it was one of those things that you like as an artist, you're like, I can't afford this shit. You know, like I can't. But whatever. I've been playing this game on my PC called Nascence. I fucking love it.
Masons?
Nascence, NAISSENCE.
What's it
It's a
about?
first person. It's a first person exploration game. There's no talking. It's an indie game. It's these levels are almost completely monochromatic. And they have really super strong light sources. Like sometimes you're following a trail of light and it creates all these cast shadows that change the look of the level all the time. So like you're trying to find your way through this environment and then you'll just come across insane, like this level of scale in the game, you know, and the abstraction of it. It's almost like a cross between David Lynch and Ridley Scott, like Blade Runner meets sort of like cubist abstraction. Like I love it. And on the PC, like fans have already added like 3D support, you know, because everything's possible on the PC. So like I've been playing it in 3D at night for like an hour at a time, and just like pillars of little smoke and these crazy like cubist like slugs coming down the side of a mountain, and there's this giant city. So you're like crawling along the rooftops and shit. I
Wait,
love it.
so do you have a when you say 3D, like you have a 3D TV and okay. That's pretty neat. Is there a lot of games that you have where they've taken it and made it where you could play it 3D?
Yeah, they have a whole bunch that they've added that aren't officially supported.
That's pretty neat.
And they're pretty good too. Like a lot of times they're even better than the whatever, because these guys are all about like making sure it works kind of thing.
Right.
I found something else. Like some of the 3D won't be perfect for these games, but I don't get headaches on the PC stuff. I think it's because the mouse and keyboard. When I play like the 3D games on my PlayStation, and I'm using like the dual analog, I get like I got Uncharted 3 that has official 3D support, right? It really gives me headaches. But I don't get it with the mouse and keyboard setup, so that's nice. But yeah, this is a game that would never be supported, you know? Like it's an indie game, they don't have the resources, maybe they don't even care, but it definitely
Right.
is awesome in 3D.
Was playing the Strider game on the Xbox One.
I tried playing that. I downloaded the demo.
It's not bad. I mean,
Yeah.
it's just I'm waiting for Titanfall to come out, so I'm just like, and I'm in a like a weird side-scrolling mood, so that's why I played the Strider, and then I went out and got the Mega Man game, just until Titanfall comes out, and then you'll never hear from me again. When I had the
That won't be
beat.
too different than how the podcast has been lately, so I don't think I'll get too hurt over it. It's okay. I'll just replace you with Andy.
Oh God, don't. I'll never hear the end of it.
He'll tell you how great everything is, and he doesn't resent coming on like you do. It's like the sniping I got from Wesley last week. It's just you on the podcast. I'm like, no, there's other people talking. They just aren't fully informed like I am. Someone has to talk. Wesley. Well, why aren't I on? Do you know anything about the subject? No? Well, then it wouldn't have sounded much different, Wesley. It's hilarious. Started watching Kill la Kill the other night.
Is it good?
Pretty bad shit crazy, bro.
I'm gonna start watching. I mean, I wrote it
It's
down.
like a cross between Project Aiko and Spawn, like
All
in a
right.
way, like you were saying?
Yeah, I wrote it down. I'm gonna start watching. I just.
It's not like Attack on Titan. It's crazy over the top shit, you know what I mean? But it's still pretty cool to watch, like they have these different suits and they give them power and some of the suits are alive and shit. It's pretty cool. A lot of sexual humor,
Kind of like what is it? High School of the Dead, I think I
Yeah,
watched.
kind of like, yeah. Far crazier though. Like over the top. Like you ever seen like Shaolin Soccer and Kung Fu Hustle?
Yeah.
It has like that kind of zaniness in an anime,
Gotcha.
Yeah, but I like it. Gurren Lagann has that too. It's the same people who do Gurren Lagann. You like Kung Fu Hustle?
Yes and no. I mean, it's not like something I'd watch every day, but it's one of those things where its own thing. I don't know.
I like Shaolin Soccer a little bit more, but it's my kind of humor.
Right.
It's smart. It's like people will still get killed in that universe. Like it's cartoony, but it's not like the fucking Mask and shit where, no one gets hurt.
Yeah.
It's more like, the next step above like Roger Rabbit, where hey, people will die in that universe. Like, tunes are fucking scary in Roger Rabbit. Like they kill each other. They don't care. No tunes ever killed a tune.
One second here. The only problem I have when I get these assignments is figuring out my layers, like what goes above what in the, because I'm not used to it. So I just sometimes I have to sit there and just not say a word or even do anything. I have to really think about what I'm doing.
Just make sure I don't think I called out these blues I'm using. So let me just reiterate these blues I'm using are really just you can see my demo sheet. B39s is really dark blue. BO5 is my mid blue, and my highlights FBG2, which is this supposed to be like this fluorescent blue, but I just found out it's that purest sky blue kind of color, Doesn't dull out. Like a lot of the light blues seem to gray out for some reason. And I'll use that gray out stuff on his like eyes, which is a B91. And probably on the shading, I'm going to have to start a little bit on the webbing. Let me let that dry for a second. Okay, a pretty easy color job on this. You look at it upside down. It's like, yeah, that'll work.
Yep. Well, you didn't do the blue on the inside of his left arm.
Thank you, Brandon.
You being sarcastic or serious?
You just can't tell, can you?
No.
I know. I have the best poker face, by the way. I just can't play the game.
I'm just saying, if you're letting the blues rest.
Really? Thank you.
You got it. You got it, pal.
I could tell when you're being sarcastic.
Yeah. I get aggressive with it. I'm like, no problem.
The problem is that you have to constantly be like me all the time in order to constantly not let people know where they stand. Yeah.
That's true.
Really, I love it when you're on. Really. What? I do. Honestly, really? Are you gonna get into this? See? Damn it. Don't know what he's doing. Just tried to I'm never gonna talk again. That's what people mostly say around me.
I just keep going. Like, I just treat it like being a baseball player. Like, I'll, keep swinging. Once in a while, you'll like what I hit.
Once in a while, you'll make a joke, and then your headset will ruin the entire podcast, and I get to delete all of it.
Was the greatest, worst moment ever.
I actually made Rob laugh, but
And no one
because of my
ever heard
incompetence, the fucking headset was unusable.
it. Was not me.
That was you.
That's the one
Wasn't
time
my ass, bro. Like,
you told me to switch
going,
headset.
that was me. You got me.
Aha, you heard
So these
it.
colors I'm using, Y35 for the yellow, YR04 chrome orange for the orange, and then I'll go into this R29. And then I'll eventually use a RVG9, which is like this deep burgundy color right here. The reason why I'm doing the yellow and oranges first is so I can control how much of it I have. So I can control how much of this I have in the image. The highlight areas, you know? I tried, you can see here on the test, I tried to kind of like, I'll do the reds first and then add orange, but here I added the yellow and orange first and then went in, and it produces a better contrast. So. Anytime you start talking about something I don't care about, I'm just going to interrupt you and start calling out marker colors. You were saying?
So, do you, when you do these, I've watched you tons of times, but when you do these colors where you do the yellow first and the orange first, like, I'm trying to think of how to word this. Do you think it really makes that much
Yeah.
more of a difference if you put the
Yeah.
yellow first?
Yeah. I'll show you the difference. On the hand, dude. Like, there's a difference between how this looks and how this looks. You know? Yeah, I can control how much I want to do. So if I want to have it more, I'll have that option. But, you can't go lighter with this unless I use Photoshop or an opaque medium.
Right.
These are transparent mediums. So you have to start light and go dark. What you're thinking is your mind doesn't think like this right now, and you don't know how to think like that. So you're trying to figure out how can I compensate without doing that? Would it really matter? And the answer is yeah, you just need to like get better.
Right. Well,
You
no,
know?
I did it when I colored a Jean Grey piece, like her suit. I started off with the yellow, and then I went to the orange, and then I went to the red, and it made a nice, cool, like, glare on the latex. So, I mean, I followed it. I was trying
I
to
mean,
think of
you
what.
want to add a ton of it. The trick is not, you know, I'm not trying to waste markers here, you know?
Right.
But I'm not doing the whole thing in orange and red, right? Like, you don't see me putting orange everywhere, and then I'm going to do a layer of red. That would just be a waste of marker.
Right.
You know, what I'm trying to do is sort of like just get that sense of having that under lightness, and I can control how much of it I want. And the only way to do that is to start light and then go dark. What other way would you do it? You know, there's no other way to do it without that. I mean, you could do it just won't be as brilliant. And so when people go, "Oh, how do you get those really bright colors?" That's how I do it. And I used to watch guys at Comic-Con do this when I was a kid. Remember, they used to color comics with markers.
All
You
right.
know? And I didn't get it when I was a kid. And I was like, "I can't. Oh, just how do you?" So I would start doing with color pencil, you know? And then I got that better. So Plus, I like to have stroke and marker variation in my lines. So, kind of going over with these little tips and adding these little extra bits and then blending them that way adds that. Instead of doing those flat blends.
Right, gives it that textured.
Yeah, gives it that little extra texture. Especially when you start to like, you know, when you, once you scan it in too and you go, hey, I'm going to go and unsharp mask this or add in, you know, overlay to a layer. You start to pop those out, those little textures and blends come back out again, you know? See, here I can control how much yellow I want his fingers to have. Maybe they won't have much, but at least there. I didn't waste that much marker arriving at that solution, you know? Then I go over with the orange and use the orange as the blender versus like a blending stick or some shit. And I didn't just do a flat red. I have these little bits sticking out. So I can throw the orange back in those little bit areas and have that little orange undercolor too, you know? So it kind of goes throughout the image, you know? Can't expect yourself to figure it out overnight though, right? You know?
Right.
I mean, however it is you're doing those motion comics now, give it a year. Gonna laugh at whatever it is you're doing now. If I'd only known.
Right now I'm doing the Marvel AR stuff.
It's like I had this guy from PhoenixCon, you know. Kind of like, and he was being cool about it, but he was like, you know, with the podcast I did with Josh, he was like talking about the con. He's like, well, you should really have relabeled this, you know, what it's like to go as a vendor, you know? This has nothing to do about being a fan. I'm like, bro, I cover being a fan in the podcast, but all my stuff is about what it's like to be an artist going to these shows, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's what my podcast is about. It's not a fan podcast, you know? I mean, so I think maybe you're on the wrong foot, you know? And then, you know, it was getting back to the whole going to con, and it's like, well, you know, he didn't say this, but I mean, like that argument comes back to like, well, you know, you're not expected to make money at cons, right? You know what I mean? As an artist, like, well, you know, you should, why are you going to con expecting to make money? I mean, and I'm like, all right, well, let me explain something, and I'm going to get back into this, right?
Huh.
These guys have never spent $1,000 or $2,000 of their money buying a table at a con, you know? Like, they never have. Whoever is a promoter, someone setting up the liaison between talent and convention, you know?
Yeah.
So when they say that kind of stuff or they come across in that manner, you know, I find it funny because, like, well, if it was their money, it'd be a whole other fucking matter. Second of all, Dean Cain ain't fucking spending $2,000 to go to Comic-Con. Dean Cain is getting the money that they fucking charge me to go to Comic-Con. So I'm subsidizing Dean fucking Cain. So Dean Cain, if the world were right, Dean Cain would be footing the $2,000 and the little guys who couldn't afford it would be getting, you know, like a placement and they'd be rotating talent in and out every other year or something. You know what I mean?
Right.
To make it an even playing field. So don't fucking tell me, dude, about, you know, at that point, then I have nothing to complain about, right? Well, you know, you got it. The talent subsidized the fucking con. You got to go because we rotate talent out. Anything you made is a bonus. Then you'd be absolutely right. Dean Cain doesn't have a right to go and bitch about cons not making an extra fucking $10,000 when he fucking made $6,000 and it cost him nothing to go and he got free hotel and airfare.
Right.
So, you know, but, yeah, I think I do expect to make my money back. That's the whole point. Matter of fact, beyond making my money back, if I spend $2,000, the idea is that, you know, and I'm a business person, you know, you're hoping to make, you know, 2-3 times that, at least.
Right.
That's their job, to promote the thing so that people show up and, those are people with dollar signs. So, you know, if it's a business venture. You know, if it was purely just fans getting together, you know, we can do that at a comic shop any weekend, right? Like,
right.
We don't need to rent space at the convention center. You know what I mean? With $20 parking and $9 fucking burritos and shit. You know, and a $12 salad.
Right. It's like the last con that I did. I mean, I didn't even make enough to cover the table, let alone $12 parking each day. You know, you have to buy food there because you can't leave and then come back. That's an extra, you know, 2 hours or whatnot. Most artists can't leave their table. And that's not including, you know, supplies, time I'm taking away from, you know, whether if I have a day job.
Even if you got smart, you're like, okay, I'll pack a lunch, I'll do all those, and you plan all that. I mean, basically, you're planning, like, a huge camping vacation. Like, you're planning an excursion, right? Like, months are devoted to this. What is this? Like, I could plan this kind and go to the Alps. You know what I mean?
And
spend almost the exact same money and expect nothing in return and at least have the experience of going to the Alps. This is all for me to drive to fucking the cinder block of America. You know what I mean? Like, I'm driving to the desert. You know, like, across the desert in the middle of summer to do this, you know? And I'm the dick, you know?
Right.
I'm the one with the misguided conception, you know? Like, or I'm misguided here in my thought process. I don't think so. I think I get it, you know?
And, oh, and I hate when people say, well, you're getting exposure. I'm like,
well, this is what everyone always gets back into, you know? Like, it's like when you work for a company. And first they start, you know, you don't get a bonus check for Christmas. And they tell you you're lucky to have a job.
All right. You know?
And then they start laying people off. And they're like, well, you're lucky it's not you. And then they start trimming hours or pay or just riding everyone's ass all the time, you know. And it's like at some point you have to say, well, what's my breaking point? And so I told the guy, I said, look, I'm the first person to remove myself from any equation if the math doesn't add up. You know, I'm not sitting here saying fix your stuff. You know, no. I'm saying you can keep it. You know, that's I just made someone that con at money. I just put $2,000 to $4,000 back in the pot. You know, I'm not taking it away from nobody. You know, but
right,
I think
yeah,
it's a crying fucking
just
shame.
Open up a spot for someone.
I think it's a crying fucking shame. You know, that's what I think. But. That's how it is. And I don't sit there and, like, at this point in my career, I don't mince, you know, words with, well, this is how it is, you know. I'm not going to sit here. I've already gotten into the, you know, how things should be conversation with myself a long time ago, especially when it came to Comic-Con, you know, in San Diego.
Right.
I'm like, here's something that's right at my back fucking door. You know, I should be able to get in. And it's like, I couldn't even get in because they were telling me because I was from San Diego. You know, priorities to out-of-towners. I'm like, that makes no fucking sense, man. You know?
Mm-hmm.
It's our con. I pay taxes at this for this fucking convention center. You know, like, my fucking taxes go to this place, dude. Priority should be to locals first. Like, what's the fucking point? So, tell me, I gotta go to some con in the middle of nowhere to get priority? And then, so I try that, and I find out places like Phoenix, they give priority to locals. I'm like, so it's just me, right? I'm fucked. Just my stupid dumb luck that these conventions, you know, never work in my favor. Yeah. So you got to work around it. But, yeah. I'm like, I get you're a promoter, and you're all butthurt because I'm not saying you're the world's greatest fucking whatever, you know? But if you want me to start naming specific cons that you as a fan should not go to, I'll do that cast too. I mean, I do this shit all the time, bro.
Right.
You know?
Man, you don't give a shit.
Yeah, and guess what? It's not going to hurt. No one's going to be like, I'm not going because Rob said so. What they'll do is go and go, you know, dude was right. If anyone says anything, you know, that's what they'll say.
Right.
I don't have a long reach, you know what I mean? I can't... Can't hurt anyone's bottom line.
Right. But you can point out the obvious. So
I just try to have integrity. You know? I don't make a podcast where I'm like trying to make everyone happy. Oh no, you know, it's a pretty good con, all things considered, but I'm not gonna go. Why are you gonna go, well, you know, I mean it's me, it's no, fuck it, it's them, it's not me. You know? Like, there's nothing I can do about it though, so I'm not gonna go. You should go. Have fun. Hope it works out for you. I'm certain it will. I mean, a lot of things don't work out for me, you know? But at this time, I'm not gonna spend my life wasting my time on those things too, you know?
Right.
Hey, is that working out for me? Great, I'll move on.
I mean, if it came down to me working on an assignment for my new job or going to a con, like right now, I'd rather choose the job over the, because it's guaranteed money.
Paid.
Yeah, it's guaranteed money. Yeah. People don't. I don't know. People wouldn't understand that. Like, oh, you're not coming. Like, no.
This isn't an altruistic medium, and they aren't altruistic either. So I hate when people try to hide behind, you know, those fucking things as art, going, well, you know, art should be about the passion. I'm like, why do you think I'm up till 2 a.m. every fucking day my entire life? You know, like, I was showing my friend video recorded of my post. I'll walk you through sometime if you ever want to see, of where I was stationed in the military over in Germany, you know? Mm-hmm. And a whole tour, you know, and I'm, like, walking through, and I'm like, this is where I was 4 years. Every day I'm drawing in that room. Every day I'm walking down here. Every day I'm writing over here. Every day, you know? And every day, like, if you knew me 15 years ago, guess what I'd be doing right now? Doesn't matter where I was. What was my excuse? I'm in the army, you know. I don't have time to draw. No, fucking fucker, I make time. And I had plenty of times when I couldn't draw, so I wrote. You know, there wasn't ever a time I wasn't doing something that didn't better, you know, or empower my creative abilities. Because I knew long term it would pay off. And it was just a better investment of my time because I want to have a career at it. I'm in this for fucking having a career. Like, I don't want to hear shit about altruism. Like, you know, I spend time with my dog, I feel better about myself, you know.
Yeah, do it for the passion. That always makes me laugh. It's like, oh, do you go to your day job and sit at your desk for the passion of it? Do you see Metallica making music for the passion of it?
Yeah.
Like,
you know,
how'd that work out for Napster?
Oh, Metallica. You know what I mean? Oh, I hate that band. Like, that's not what I'm talking about, dumbass.
Right.
You know, like, that's the difference between you and me, you know, is you've accepted that the reason why you haven't made money is because you don't have to. You know, I'm here to make money, and if I'm not receiving money, it's because I'm doing something wrong. I don't blame my audience either, you know?
Right.
Either it means I got to get better, or I got to start being more creative, or I got to improve certain things, or I got to get a better reach. And there is no, like, there's no way to, there's no, like, one way to do that, you know?
Right.
The website of how to be a successful artist, like, you know, and I don't care how many do that, you know, here's what I did. There'll be someone who did the complete opposite and was 10 times more successful.
Right.
You know? Like, there isn't a one way. This is coming out fairly easy. All too easy. I'll show you something, too. I gotta let these markers dry for a second. 1 second. Let's see if I can reach it. I had one of these signed when I was a kid, and when I joined the army, my buddy raided some old friends of friends, quote-unquote, raided my stuff where my dad lived and took all my shit. So I don't have it anymore, but I managed to get this in pristine condition. Signed by Stephen Platt, Todd Nock, Al Quiza, and some other dude I never heard of.
Nice.
Oh, Sabal, yeah. Anchor Sabal. Yeah. I had these same guys. I went to the Extreme Super Tour in San Diego when they came down. This is the Appleseed cover, Liefeld Janked. He janked this from Appleseed, yeah.
Wait, so was Todd Nock part of Extreme?
Yeah, he was Drew Newman.
Ah.
Yeah. See, there's Newman right there. And I'll show you Todd in here. Like, where's Todd? This is the Youngblood Year One promo poster. Liefeld did this because he wanted to get Kurt Busiek to write it. And they had never signed anything. He just made this poster. I used to have this big poster at a con they gave away. But it never actually existed.
Oh, is that the one where he lied and said he was going to be right in?
Yeah. Where is Todd Nock in here? Here he is. Huh?
Oh, wow.
I know, right? Young dude, right?
Merritt Michaels. I didn't realize he was that.
Oh, yeah. Well, he was always like, even at Marvel, Merritt and Dan Fraga were, Liefeld was doing roughs and they were finishing up stuff. I wonder
Oh,
whatever
yeah.
happened to Chap Yeap.
Dan
I always liked his
Fraga,
stuff.
I started following him on Facebook and all his other art stuff about a month ago. Or no, about 60 days ago.
I'm gonna totally do something, not obviously on this issue of Game Cave, but on one of them, I'm definitely gonna do something where like they review some 90s comic that don't actually exist or some shit. Or I'll be like, this is a comic I always wanted to do, and I'll just create a typical like 90s comic. 'Cause I can draw like this now, you know?
Right.
I can do all this crazy shit that no company will hire you to do now. See, this right here, no matter what this is, would still look dope on a t-shirt today.
Right.
You know what I mean? The super realistic stuff doesn't work on a t-shirt. That's what's crazy. And video games look like this. You know what I mean? Like,
Right.
they look like this. Titanfall is more like this than, say, you know, Alex Ross. That's what's crazy. But you put this in a comic and people go, "Oh, let's fucking look at that. Oh, it doesn't. Oh, no. I'm like, whatever. You know?" It's pretty funny.
Dan Frag.
Look at the live Brad Rock. Oh, look at it. Remember that dude used to dress up like Chapel?
Yeah.
Yeah, I met him at con. This right here, this is Platt, and I don't know this dude coming out the Youngblood Jet. That's the Youngblood Jet. Yeah, they had the Jet at Comic Con. It's probably from Comic Con. See those badges? Those look like Comic Con badges. That's probably 94. I was there. This is the actual Extreme Studios. They used to have a pit. They'd all sit there drawing. No computers. See that? Woo! You know what crazy part is, dude? I'll show this before I get back to working. Is where is it? That's Christian Lichner.
Oh, wow.
He looks like the Hank McCoy from X-Men First Class. You know that dude dating Jennifer Lawrence?
Right.
Young version, right? Born in Switzerland. He went to law school. Crazy, right? Yeah. Thought you'd get a kick out of that.
Was gonna say, oh, the Dan Fraga guy. He posted the other day. I guess he has that Captain America Liefeld cover.
Oh yeah, the
Yeah.
actual pencils.
Yeah.
Nice.
On some weird paper. I think it was it looked like an original, but it was funny. I didn't know who he was until, I saw him
I tell you're a big fan of Black Flag. Black Flag, dude. Like yeah, Nightmare. Not Merritt Michaels.
I
Yeah,
looked him
Dan
up, and
Fraga.
he did like video directing, like videos and art storyboards also, and
Sure. Well, they all got into Hollywood. I mean,
right. It didn't
they're not.
mention the Extreme Studios when I looked him up, but it mentioned like directed an NSYNC video and shit like that. But that's cool. I didn't know that. I mean, I saw.
For some reason, a lot of guys are ashamed of their past, or they don't want to remember Rob and his crazy shenanigans. Seems to be like if you bring up Extreme Studios, there's a lot of bitterness. It reminds me of bringing up Game Fan. You know, like you bring up Dave Halvorson.
I'll ask Todd Knock about it when I see him at Phoenix Con. Him and he's really nice and
I know. My buddy Dan is really good friends with him and brought him by the play booth back in 2009. At the time, he was checking out with him. He's like, dude, you really? And I'm like, thanks.
and his wife always remember Jessica's name, but not mine. So we saw them when we went to go to that San Diego con that one day.
Seems
They're like,
right.
all right, yeah. They're like, hey Jessica, both of them, right? And then Todd Knott goes, I want to say Scott. I'm like, you're close, Brandon. And he's like, oh my bad. I'm like, that's
Samsonite.
cool, Samsonite. But whatever, she's the happy one. Everybody's like, oh, it's Jessica, and then it's Brandon. Let's see. What I read or what people know
You
my
know how much that
name.
thing cost me?
$5.
Less than that. You know how much it means to me? A lot more.
Right.
You know? That's what I love. The stuff I love is dirt cheap on eBay. You know? That's what I love. You gotta.
How much would you have paid for it if.
I wouldn't have paid more than $15, maybe. You know? Because I know what this stuff's worth, you know?
Right.
There's just too much of it running around. And, you know, like, look, it was a speculator's market, you know. I learned a lot about economics watching comics at that time, you know, and perceived value. And what happens when everyone says something's going to be the next big thing, what happens, you know?
Right.
And how that doesn't work out. That's why I stayed away from Bitcoin. I mean, I knew about that from the very beginning. It's like, Rob, you could have made a killing. I'm like, yeah, but I had a feeling that anytime you start competing with the American dollar, you know what I mean? The government's going to come after you eventually.
I don't even know what Bitcoin is. Like, I've seen that because I don't.
Digital currency that can't be traced or tracked or nothing like that, dude. And I could have got in at a very early time. You know, maybe I've been a millionaire if you really think about it. But I believe long term. Like, I always think. The prison movies don't start, you know, like, how long did it take him to get Al Capone, you know, like, you know, like, I'm just like, you know, when it comes to competing with the dollar, I just don't want the IRS in my life, you know, like,
right,
like, I don't care.
I mean, I saw that the main guy was in trouble or something, but I just.
No, it's just one of the vendors, you know, Mt. Gox or whatever.
So the business is still going then.
Well, it's not a business. It's a currency. It's a digital currency. There's different people that brokerage in it, you know, a different, you know, like, it's complicated, James. It's not one place that created it. So it's not a one-to-one like Extreme Studios, but it is a whole industry. You know, when you start dealing with bubbles, you know, be wary of when people say this is the next big thing, you know, because very people, if people really knew that, you know.
Right.
I'm like, well, if I really want to deal in currency, I'll just make my art more valuable. You know? Then I can just create whatever money I want. Just draw some stuff. Do-do-do.
Sketchcraft.
But I also picked up a couple issues. A couple.
Hello.
But yeah.
I would buy a Nintendo Wii if they had like that, where they had the Mega Man Legends and, you know, like maybe like how PlayStation's doing
Will
their.
never happen. Capcom, they were making Mega Man Legends 3 exclusively for 3DS, and Capcom just dropped it for no reason. That's why Inafune quit Capcom. And he's making Mighty No. 9.
Oh yeah, that's right,
Of
Andy.
course, he waited 2 years because of
About
his
that.
non-compete. That's why, like, when I was having this conversation with, like, the guys over at Retro, you know, like, oh, he's gonna get totally sued. I'm like, no, I don't think you get it. He waited the 2 years. You look at the day he left and time, you know, you can't get sued because you made something similar to something you'd done before. You know, like, when that's like, we used to get this in animation. It's like there was a guy, you remember the cartoon Bobby's World? That guy sold off the look of his art to that company. He was never allowed to draw commercially like that again, you know, like, and that doesn't happen anymore. You can't sell a look, you know, like he ended up suing and successfully winning after that shit, but yeah. So what they really do is assign these non-competes. So he was non-competing for 2 years. I said, if anything, Capcom will end up publishing it, which will be the weird turn of fucking fate, being that they wouldn't fucking do shit with Mega Man, you know, but
Right.
whatever. A Halo here with BO5. I'm gonna go to lunch next week with my buddies over at IDW.
Nice.
Already turned down working for them, so now we can all go to lunch and catch up. Driving nuts.
It's just funny. It's I, you know, it's you're at the stage where I wish I was at, you know, where you could just, no, I'm good. Turn
Oh
it down.
no. Believe me, no one ever says you're at that, anyone's at that stage. Why would you ever turn down work? I'm just, it's like, you ever seen that episode of Seinfeld, Do the Opposite? When Costanza just starts doing the opposite and he starts to have total success in his life? I've just decided that all the
Okay,
moves
I
I
get
ever
you.
made were completely, like, I'm just doing the opposite of everything I would have ever done before. And it's working.
Just to touch back on that, is that the one where he comes into work wearing like a t-shirt and like he
No,
stops
he
wearing a
didn't have a
suit?
job at the time. He had been out of a job
Oh.
for like through 2 or 3 seasons.
Oh, okay.
Rob, that's a fictional character. I'm like, yeah, well, you know, artists model a lot of their lives after fictional characters. That's, you know,
Right.
it's new there, you know.
Ever watch the movie Monkey Bone?
Long time ago, dude. That's Bob Sel Selleck, Henry Selleck, the guy who directed that. Ended up doing Coraline, you know. He
Okay.
directed Nightmare Before Christmas, but he never got any credit for.
Did you
Of
like it?
him, Monkey Bone?
Yeah.
No, it's a comedy of errors, dude. But it holds up in a strange way, more like a cult film now, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
I was watching it last night or the night before, and I mean, Brendan Fraser, you know, he's cool, he's fun, but I like the style of everything, you know, over the top shapes and
Yeah, that's Henry Selick right there. That's the art director. Yeah.
just couldn't really kind of try putting it on. I was like, just give it like 10 minutes. He's like, I'm over it. I was like, all right.
It's a cult movie. Yeah.
Let's see.
I've actually had my schedule down pretty good the last 2 weeks. Like, I'm actually writing every day at the same time, working on commissions every day at the same time, you know, and then this
Nice.
stuff every day at the same time, like, and then going to sleep, stopping at a certain time, you know, and
Right.
it's working, you know, like, it actually, it's amazing how that can actually.
I thought on the knee there. Did you have on the original sketch, like, the knee ripped open? The costume?
No.
Oh.
Just looking at the sh you're seeing into the shading, bro. No, his
Okay.
costume isn't ripped.
I hate drawing Spider-Man.
Why?
I'm not good enough yet with bodies to even attempt his abnormally moving body, I guess. I don't know. I just have trouble with it, like, because all, you know, the legs curling underneath and the footing, I just.
It depends on who draws them, right? I
Yeah.
mean, John Romita Sr. didn't really do any of that shit, you know?
Right. He was just big and blocky, I guess.
I mean, like, I draw him skinny here because I don't want to hear it from people. But I subscribe more to the McFarlane way of drawing him, you know? I never really saw him as an ultra skinny guy. But that seems to be the zeitgeist now, you know? When you start to play him against like Venom and stuff, I guess the shapes pop better that way. But you know, if I were drawing just me as Spider-Man, he wouldn't be ultra thin. But I let this one go. You know, I'm like, ah, whatever, he's fine. It's fun drawing little skinny dudes.
Right.
I know you'd appreciate the thinner Spider-Man. You like your men skinny, right? Right, Brandon?
It.
That's true.
There's only one big bear in the relationship. That's me.
Yeah, that's right. That is right. I learned that. Was a big question tonight. It was like, do I make Venom purpley or bluish? I side on purple. But because it's Marvel Capcom, I just said, well, fuck it, I'll just go with the blues. Seemed to be he's more bluish in the game anyway.
Yeah, and the game is bluish, but I always think that when, like, an object is so dark black, I always like it when it has a purple shade.
Well, what I'm gonna do, just to put a little in there, is I'll edge light his blues with the VO4. Not on Spider-Man, but like on Venom. So there'll be these purple hues around the edge, you know? So they'll be in there, but yeah, I guess I did a purplish version, and it just didn't look like the one from the game, you know?
All right.
And that's when I was like, well, I don't want to hear it, you know? I can always throw some extra lighting in on the digital side, you know?
Right.
Like his slime, his little green venom slime will be digital. I'm not even gonna attempt it with the markers. Markers, these markers don't do very well with those kinds of. This
See, and I'm
creative edging is sorry. This creative edging is something that I end up deleting actually from the final art, like when I go digital. It's really just for the physical art piece, you know? But it looks pretty good. And then I've tried adding this after, but it smears colors. So if you're gonna do it, you gotta do it before you start. You were gonna say?
I was gonna say, so you thought I'd be months before I was back on the recording.
It's been almost an entire month.
Just not good timing for
It takes
both of
30
us.
days. Every time someone starts a new job, I did just disappear. Like, come on, man. I know
Well,
the deal.
your timing's bad though. It's like
It's not my timing.
if you hit me up anytime before
Yeah,
5, it's fine,
my fault.
but
You're right, it's my fault.
it
How
is.
many times have I hit you up before 5, dude? Plenty of times. You you're
I
fucking crazy.
don't know.
I gotta start logging when I email you or call you. What about
Yeah.
now? Do you know what it'll be? Well, today was the one time, because, yeah, sure, right, the one time. All right, you got me. Stay even busy, man. Don't blame me. I shoulder
Just
enough blame in my life. I don't need you piling on, dude.
like I don't know when it was, last Monday or something, and I was like, we gotta get home. I told Rob I'm gonna record, and then I rush, and then right before I get home, you're like, yeah, I'm done for the day. I was like, ah, oh, shit. like,
Yeah,
damn
that's how
it.
it goes, bro. I got
It's
my work done. I got my work done. I'm not staying up late. I'm fucking out, dude.
all right.
So today was a little bit, I'm a little behind, but that's because I scanning these things in takes a little bit longer than you think sometimes.
Did they
But
even change out your router?
that
Or
was all
what?
Sunday. Yeah, but I mean, I had some drops today, but it didn't really affect some stuff I was streaming on this rig. So I don't know. You know what I mean?
Right.
We'll just see how it goes. But yeah, I mean, like, I tried to stream when I was drawing this guy, and that didn't work out very well. Like, it crashed.
Are we recording podcast this week?
Wednesday.
Wednesday.
Let's give it 10:30.
Your time or my time?
My
Okay.
time. Always my time, bro. I don't know your time.
Sounds good to me.
Gonna record Game Cave at 9. I got Wesley James. I invited Wes Andy to come back for that,
Yeah, he already texts me all excited. He's like,
so.
we're talking Nintendo. I love Nintendo and all the, the
Because he doesn't listen
consoles.
to the podcast, right? Like, because that's all I ever do, you know? Drives fucking Wesley and them batshit crazy. Why do you care so much? I'm like, because it's my fucking podcast. You fucking do your own shit. Why do I care?
I
It's
went and bought Mega Man ZX. I was playing that the last day or so. Felt like playing some Mega Man and side scrollers.
Man,
Did you like any of that or no? Or did you ever play any of that?
the original Mega Man X games are pretty cool. The Zero game is not really my thing, but you know.
Right. Because they had the, what was it, the
I
Zero?
really like Mega Man Legends. I just wish someone would fucking fix the play control on that. Like, just add dual analog support.
Right.
All right, everybody, welcome back to Sketchcraft Live. Hopefully the stream holds. Today, tonight, whenever you're watching this, I shall be coloring the Spider-Man you see here with these Copic markers you see here. Joining me today is Brandon from leadheavyart.com. Remember LeadHeavy?
LeadHeavy.com.
Man, fucking fix your email, bro. Fuck every
I
time.
think I kind of like that. You don't like
Hey, good for you, bro, but when people are, like,
it.
trying to type in your email, it's your fucking problem, not mine, you
Right.
know? Good for you, you know? I kind of like that people don't know what the hell you're talking about, Rob. That does well for my bottom line. All right, so I'll call out Copic markers as always, as I'm working right along here. This is a copy of the pencils. I've drawn it separately, and then I print out this stuff. I've tinted the lines this time. Sometimes I do that. I already did a rough experimentation. Ignore this. Calling out some numbers and stuff for myself. So I found that this actually helps just waste an extra piece of paper doing it, but whatever, saves me from having to go back and like the Star Fox, you know what I mean? Paper I'm printing out on and working on is B marker paper. B marker paper. So, print this out. It's actually meant to be seen like this, but I'll be coloring right side up so my brain doesn't fucking go loco here. Gonna start with the W3, just do some creative edging. Not really gonna do any shadowing on him because he's gonna be a little bit more bright and poppy. So, here we go. How you been, Brandon?
So-so. Work was non-existent the last probably 10 days, and out of nowhere he's like, "Hey, I got an assignment for you if you could have it done by w Wednesday, but hopefully you could have it done by tomorrow." And I'm like, "All right." And he's like, "It's a big assignment too." So I'm like, "Oh, sweet. I'm not sleeping tonight."
Welcome to the world of fucking bullshit production, right?
Yeah.
Time for you to pay your dues. I remember when I was told that by the David over at Ape. He's like, "Why not, Rob? You gotta pay your dues." And I had already been doing t-shirts for like several years, you know, getting cursed at and shit. I'm like, "Pay my fucking dues," like, you know, like.
But I need the money so I can be like, no, I don't want this assignment. Hit me on the
Yeah,
next
well,
one.
the first time you say no, guess what happens?
Yeah.
It's the last time you hear from him. Give it a year. That's exactly what ends up happening. I mean, so you got to figure out what game you're in, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So you're in the fucking acquiring work game. So you just say, yeah. But it's like the cover I did for Retro, you know what I mean? They were like, oh, we need it by the 1st of February. Then I talked to the art director after I turned in the first draft, you know, my first turn-in.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, so when's this really due? He's like, oh, we really don't need it until like the 13th of February. He's like, but I doubt the issue will be done by then anyhow. So I went back and recolored it, and he saw that.
Yeah.
And then issue's still in. I checked out their Twitter yesterday, and it's like, yeah, we're thinking mid-March. But I like it. I like the art got turned in before their fucking writing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's nice. Little details tend to make a mess. I'm supposed to get both of them colored tonight, but with scanning and everything else, I was like, well, I'm pretty sure I can get Spider-Man done, though. Plus, my neck has been killing me. I slept on it wrong. That's always tough, right? Like,
right.
You're like, I gotta look down. There's no way I can marker this shit vertically.
Yeah, I don't know if I tweaked mine at volleyball last Thursday or sleeping on it wrong, but I woke up the other day, too, and it was just, it kills, and I'm just like sitting here at the desk, and I'm just like,
no. Well, it's one of those things that you're like, as an artist, you're like, I can't afford this shit. You know, like, like I can't. But whatever. I've been playing this game on my PC called Nascence. I fucking love it.
Nascence?
Nascence. Naissence.
What's
it's
it
a
about?
first person exploration game. There's no talking. It's an indie game. It's these levels are almost completely monochromatic. And they have really super strong light sources. Like sometimes you're following a trail of light and it creates all these cast shadows that change the look of the level all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So like you're trying to find your way through this environment and then you'll just come across insane, like this level of scale in the game. You know, and the abstraction of it. It's almost like a cross between David Lynch and Ridley Scott, like Blade Runner meets sort of like Cubist abstraction. Like, I love it. And on the PC, like, fans have already added, like, 3D support, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because everything's possible on the PC. So, like, I've been playing it in 3D at night for, like, an hour at a time. And just, like, pillars of little smoke and these crazy, like, cubist, like, slugs coming down the side of a mountain, and there's this giant city, so you're, like, crawling along the rooftops and shit.
Do you have a, when you say 3D, like, you have a 3D TV and...
Yeah.
Okay. That's pretty neat.
Yeah.
Is there a lot of games that you have where they've taken it and made it where you could play it 3D?
Yeah, they have a whole bunch that they've added that aren't officially supported.
That's pretty neat.
And they're pretty good too. Like a lot of times they're even better than the whatever, because these guys are all about like making sure it works kind of thing.
Right.
I found something else. Like some of the 3D won't be perfect for these games, but I don't get headaches on the PC stuff. I think it's because the mouse and keyboard. When I play like the 3D games on my PlayStation and I'm using like the dual analog, I get like I got Uncharted 3 that has official 3D support, right? It really gives me headaches. I don't get it with the mouse and keyboard setup, so that's nice. But yeah, this is a game that would never be supported, you know? Like, it's an indie game, they don't have the resources, maybe they don't even care, but it definitely
Right.
is awesome in 3D.
I was playing the Strider game on the Xbox One.
I tried playing that. I downloaded the demo.
It's not bad. I mean, it's
Yeah.
just I'm waiting for Titanfall to come out, so I'm just like, and I'm in a, like a weird side-scrolling mood. So that's why I played the Strider, and then I went out and got the Mega Man game.